Welcome to Palapinic Cowboy Church. We're so glad that you're joining us today. If this is your first time here to view Palapinic County Cowboy Church, we're glad that you're watching the video today. My name is Roger Keck. I am the pastor here at the church, and we want to invite you to continue to come back. PalapinicCowboyChurch.com has all of the sermons on it, and they are posted each week. And so I hope that you will be able to look and check out these sermons for yourself. If you're searching for a church home, I agree that that may be one of the best ways to figure out if you'd like to come visit us or not is by looking at us online. So I hope you get a chance to review several of those. If you'd like to come visit us in person, eyeball to eyeball, we are at 2731 South FM 129 in Santo, Texas, 76472. And we would be glad to have you. We'd like to shake your hand and get to know you. If you are visiting with us and you are looking for a church home, or you enjoy being able to watch the videos at the house and you would still like to be a part of this church, you can participate by giving to this church and giving to the ministries of this church by going to the giving button that is located at PalapinicCowboyChurch.com under the title Giving, and it will prompt you to go in there and be able to give towards the ministries of this church. If you're listening by Pure Country Radio, and maybe you like doing that, you can also do that as well. That helps take care of the cost associated with broadcasting radio from this location. We're so glad that you're here. We'll hope that you join us. We hope that you come and see us. We look forward to getting a chance to meet you. God bless.
Turn your handout over. Man, my tongue's not working very good today. And join us in singing Last Railway to Heaven.
Your trust.
I'll tell you what, let's give Ridge one more hand because he's going to be going to Nashville. He and Grace. We're going to change things up a little bit on you. We're going to sing I Cast My Bread Upon the Water. Hey. Singing a little bit of Victory in Jesus. Okay, Deb is going to do a song that I say this, I think, everything that Debbie sings, but I just don't think anybody does this any better than Debbie. This is a song originally recorded by Big Daddy Weave, Redeemed.
Oh God.
Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Get your phone out. Get your phone out. Everybody's got one. Don't look at me like you don't know what I'm talking about. Everybody carries one. It's that other appendage besides both arms that you carry around with you. Get that thing out. Go to your calendar, if you would, please. Go to your calendar in your phone. And I want you to mark October 1st through 3rd. All right? And I'm fixing to give you the times. That is a Friday. That is a Saturday, and that is a Sunday. Now, how many of you grew up going to revivals? That's not what this is. Kinda. It kinda is, but yeah, we decided not to call it a revival. Revival is a very old-fashioned term, but let me just tell you what the word revival means. The word revival means to revive. All right, the word to revive doesn't mean that we're trying to revive the dead. It means we're trying to energize the living. All right? And so this 3 days is for the living. All right? And it is to energize us into next year to do what God's called this church to do. And by the way, it's not sit on our duff and worry about what's going to happen. Let me repeat that. Some of you didn't hear that. It's not to sit on our duff. We have been given an assignment as God's children to go out and tell people about Jesus Christ. That's what we are called to do. We are going to get energized to go do that. Amen? So Friday night, 7 p.m. By the way, all of this is going to be down at the arena. First time we've ever gotten a chance to do this, okay? But it's all going to be in an arena. I don't care if it rains. Guess what? We're still going to have it down there. All right? Because in October, you can't ever tell. But 7 p.m. Will be when the service starts. Now, we're going to feed on Friday and Saturday night at 6 o'clock before we have the service at 7. So if you'd like to come eat with us, we'd love to have you. All right? So we're going to feed at 6. The service will be at 7. We've got three different speakers coming. Friday night is Tater Pascal. Tater Pascal is out of Meridian, and I tell you what, you're going to want to hear him. He's awesome. He's already called me twice or three times saying, hey, brother, God's already speaking. And so I think that is so good. Saturday night, again, we'll feed at 6, start at 7. Worth Mays. Worth is the preacher over at Erath County Cowboy Church, and I don't know if you've ever had a chance to hear Worth. Worth is an incredible preacher. He was a seminary professor at one time, but now I don't want that to scare you off. He's not going to talk about over our heads. He's just a very gifted man when it comes to speaking God's word. And he'll be here Saturday night. And by the way, Saturday night, the testimony is going to be from McKinnon Wimberly. Okay? Now, I don't know how many of you follow bull riding, but if you ever followed bull riding, McKinnon's a bull rider. All right? And so this is going to be interesting testimony for sure. And then Sunday, it'll be a regular worship service, except it'll be in the arena. All right, so what we're going to do is 10:30 Sunday morning, we're going to meet back at the arena. Our special music's going to be Tony Booth. All right, Tony's coming back. Okay, he's got some stuff on a gospel CD he's going to do for us. And then I don't know how many of you are familiar with a guy named Steve Fiskup, but Steve Fiskup is the guy that does Coffee with a Colonel. All right, maybe some of you have seen this, but Steve is going to be preaching for us on Sunday morning to wrap up our revival. All right, good stuff, amen? So I want you to do me a favor, on your calendar, put on there, bring lawn chair. Bring lawn chair.
You can sit in the dirt if you want to, but that's fine. I mean, we'll have a few chairs down there, I'm sure, but my guess is you'd be a whole lot more comfortable probably if you'd bring your lawn chair and sit in it. Good? Okay. So do me a favor, help spread this around. I am really looking forward to this. This has been in the planning for several months, and I am really, really, really pumped about this. Now, let me tell you why I'm so pumped about it. I'm pumped about it because I really honestly think we have got to move forward. We've got to get over the fear of this COVID thing. We got to get over the fear of what's going on in this world, and we got to start moving forward. Amen? We got to. Now, I agree. We got some folks out this morning. We got a long list of people with COVID. So I'm going to give you one other assignment to do. My dad found this, and I think he's exactly right. And I'm just going to read a very small portion of it, but I want you to write down Psalm 91. Psalm 91. And when you get back to your home today, I want you to read Psalm 91 out loud with your family. With your family present, Psalm 91. Whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge, He is my fortress, He is my God in whom I trust. Surely He will save you from the fowler's snare and from that deadly pestilence. He will cover you with His feathers, and under His wings you will find refuge. And His faithfulness will be your shield and your rampart. You will not fear the terror of night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor the pestilence. By the way, the other word for pestilence is disease that stalks you in the darkness. You will not fear it. I want you to hear me. Hear me. You either believe God or you don't. You either have faith or you don't. You cannot ride the fence here. We're either one or the other. And I tell you what, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord, and I believe God is still in control. Claim that in your home today, will you? Go home. Claim it in your home. Claim it with your family. Because I'm telling you, and you can read the rest of it. I didn't read all of it today because I want to move on. But go claim that with your family. Trust me. We need to step out of fear and step into grace, mercy, and strength in Jesus Christ. That's what we got to do. Today, we are finishing up the purpose test, okay? Or the character test is what I should have said, with the purpose test, all right? I know that this has been kind of a long series, and several people have asked me, well, preacher, how do I know what my purpose is? How do I know what my destiny is? And I am so glad you asked that question, because I'm going to answer it today for you. I know somebody's going to get excited. All right, I'm going to stop. Right turn. I'm chasing rabbits like crazy today. So any of you who are good, it's almost dove season, so if anybody has got their shotgun, you might want to shoot some of these. But I got to tell you something. This week, I'm going to preach this. Next week, Dave Wills is going to be here because Dana and I are going to go hear those two kids at the Opry, okay? And we're going to go support them. But the week after I get back, okay, now you got to be here, and I'm not going to tell you what we're going to do, but let's just say this, you ain't had fun in church like we're going to have fun in church when I get back, okay? And the reason I'm going to give you the title of the message, it's called Happy Dance. Happy Dance, all right? So that's when I get back. Don't miss it. Trust me, you're going to want to be here. If for no other reason, you're going to want to see this, okay? But I think that this is going to change your heart about how you honor and you worship God. Okay? Don't miss it. All right. Genesis chapter 45 is where we're going to be today. How can we know the purpose of our lives? And before I read this, I want to give you a little background to it. We're backing up a little bit in the timeline of this story of Joseph. And this is the first time that he sees his brothers since they sold him into slavery. Okay? Now, you can only imagine that if your brother or sister sold you into slavery, what you might think might go through your mind, right? Oh boy, is this going to be fun. Here they come, Revenge is mine, right? Right? Yes. So Joseph is now 39 years of age, and Egypt has had 7 years of plentiful harvest and is in 2 years of poor harvest. Okay, remember we told you that he had a dream. He interpreted Pharaoh's dream. And the brothers are now coming to buy grain to keep from starving to death. And this is where we pick up the story. So I'm going to ask if you'll stand with me. Genesis chapter 45, starting with verse 3. Genesis 45, starting with verse 3. If you didn't bring your Bible or you don't have one on your phone, the words will be up here for you to read. Joseph said to his brothers, I am Joseph. Is my father still living? But his brothers were not able to answer him because they were terrified at his presence. I bet they were. Then Joseph said to his brothers, come close to me. When they had done so, he said, I am your brother Joseph, the one you sold into Egypt. Can anybody say, uh-oh? And now, this is what's so great about this. And now, do not be distressed and do not be angry with me. No, it says with yourself. Don't be angry with yourselves for selling me here, because it was to save lives that God sent me ahead of you. For 2 years now, there has been a famine in the land, and for the next 5 years, there will be no plowing or reaping. But God sent me ahead of you. Now, you need to underline that. But God sent me ahead of you to preserve you for a remnant on earth and to save your lives by a great deliverance. Verse 8, so then, it was not you who sent me here. Pay attention to this. Write it down. Underline it. Do whatever you got to do. It was not you that sent me here, but God. He made me father to Pharaoh, lord of his entire household, and ruler of all Egypt. Let's pray. Father, I thank you so much for your word this morning. And Father, as we come together and worship you and honor you, Father, I pray that you would be glorified. Father, through the airways on Pure Country Radio, online for those who are watching us from home, Father, we just pray right now that your word would reach out and touch a heart today. In Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. I truthfully believe that this was Joseph's aha moment. Have you ever had an aha moment? Yes? How many of you have had an aha moment before? Okay, good. I believe this was Joseph's aha moment. This was God's purpose for Joseph's life. So how can you know and discover the purpose for your life? And again, I'm real glad you asked that question. So I'm going to ask you to take notes this morning. Number one, believe you have a purpose. Believe you have a purpose. Now, I want you to look at your neighbor and say, you have a purpose. Good. This is the number one question in anybody and everybody's hearts, isn't it? As a matter of fact, the people that seem to cause the most trouble in the world are asking the question, what is my purpose? They're trying to figure out what their purpose is in this life. And it's been a question that's been asked for generations upon generations upon generations. And then the next question is, does God even have a purpose for me? And the answer to that question is, of course he does. Of course he does. Otherwise, you wouldn't be here. Everything has a purpose, which means you have a particular purpose. You know, even ants, skunks, and mice have a purpose. I don't know what that purpose is. I have no idea what that purpose is. If anybody can tell me, please do. But I have no idea why ants, skunks, and mice have a purpose. But God does not create anything that does not have a purpose to it. Ecclesiastes 3:1 says, there is a time And I put on my notes a season, because some of your translations will say that. There is a season for everything. Have you wondered why there are some people that have passed away before COVID got here? And have you wondered why some of those people have passed away during COVID? And have you wondered why there are some people that got COVID and didn't pass away? Because there is a season for every single thing. There's a time for it. And God has that time marked out. And it doesn't matter. You know, I was talking with a friend of mine the other day, and we were talking about Margie Bayless, Terry's wife. And I said, the thing about it is if COVID hadn't got her, something else would have, because God says this is the time that your life is up. And it doesn't matter. He ordains the beginning of things. He ordains the end of them. And he ordains the season that's in between that. Does everybody understand that? Okay, good. There is a purpose for every single activity under heaven. Yeah, hang on before you say amen, because some of you, like me, have been groaning, complaining, and everything else about what's going on in this world right now. I want to reread that. There is a purpose for every activity under heaven, even the ones we don't agree with. Everything has a purpose. Even that annoying neighbor of yours or that annoying co-worker of yours has a purpose. And somebody came to your mind just like that, didn't it? Now, the best way to discover your purpose is to look how God made you. All right? God made each of us unique. Amen? Now, I know this is kind of old. I can't help it, but every time I use this word, I got to do this. Does anybody in here know how you catch a unique bird? Unique up on it. That's exactly right. Oh, so you don't have any sense of humor today. Is that what it is? Okay. Okay. My wife's going, you see, she's shaking her head right now. Help me decide what its purpose ought to be. Now, this could be anything. I mean, we could put it down here. We might could do like a ring toss game with it. Maybe that's its purpose, right? Maybe. We could turn it over, stick it in the ground, and it could be a bird bath for hummingbirds. Or, if you're anything like me, and you have no hair, I'm not going to stick this on my head, but it could be a hat that won't blow off in the summer or the winter, right? But most of you know by looking at this what the purpose of this thing is. Now, I'm not stupid enough to get into the purpose for this, okay? But you know what it is, right? Because you can recognize it by the way it looks and the way it's designed. You have a design. The Creator designed you for a particular purpose. A particular purpose. I'll come back to this here in a minute. Didn't know I was going to use a plunger today, did you? So I want you to do something. I want you to ask yourself, what do I look like? I'm not asking you to say, what do I look like physically? I want you to ask yourself, what do I look like in the spirit? What do I look like in the spirit, not in the flesh? I believe the flesh can be deceptive, but the spirit is not. The spirit's not deceptive. All right, good. Now, if you have the spirit of deliverance, in which, by the way, I'm going to tell you, you might look like this thing right here in the spirit. That was a joke, and you didn't get it. How many of you got that joke? I worked all week on that joke, and nobody got it. That was a good one, too, by the way. You're going to think about that, and when you get up, you're going to get up Thursday morning and go, ah, that was funny. I got it now. I got it. Number two, you need to understand that God is in control. God is in control. Now, boy, I tell you what, you talk about a timely message here. Amen? For you to understand what your purpose is in this life, your life, you need to understand the following. Are you ready? Number one, you need to understand there will be setbacks. I didn't say might be, didn't say should be. I said there will be setbacks. Be advised, not everything is going to go your way. Not everything is going to go your way. Number two, there's going to be some difficulties. There's going to be some difficulties. Not everything in your life is going to come easy to you. Some of this you're going to have to work for. I don't know. Is Ridge in the room? He probably is. But let me just tell you something about that young man right there. It just ticks me off that a kid that age has that much talent. It does, because, you know, again, you know, some of us have worked and worked and worked. But the thing about it is, I will tell you about Ridge. Ridge works at what he does. That's the reason why he can play the way he does, is because he's exercised his gift. But I guarantee you it didn't come without some difficulty. Your gift, your talent, your purpose is not going to come without you experiencing some difficulties. It's going to happen. There are going to be challenges. Number three, and I know this is going to be a real shock to some of you, but not everybody's going to like you. Not everybody's going to like you. Not everybody's going to like your purpose. Amen? If you are people pleasers, this is going to be tough. This is going to be tough. There's a good chance that they may even spread some rumors or some lies about you. It's possible. You have to understand that God has a purpose for your life, and it is God that is in control, not you. Not you. Genesis 45:5. And now do not be distressed and do not be angry with yourselves for selling me here, because it was to save lives that God sent me ahead of you. We read this just a minute ago. I want you to think about this for just a minute. Joseph was sold as a slave. He was falsely accused and sent to prison. But the entire time both and all of this was going on, Joseph understood that I'm not in control. There is a higher power that is, and that's Jesus Christ. Now, if you miss anything else, listen to me real carefully. Water must be water time. Hang on. I don't want you to miss this. Do not miss this. No one can derail you from your destiny but you. Nobody can derail you from your destiny but you. You can derail it. Stop believing that you cannot fulfill your purpose because of what somebody else did to you. Listen to me carefully. Stop thinking that there is no way you're ever going to fulfill your purpose because of your past or what somebody else did to you. Amen? Romans 8:28. And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him and have been called according to his purpose. Isaiah 55:10-11. As the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return to it without watering the earth and making it bud and flourish so that it yields seed for the sower and bread for the eater, so is my word that goes out from my mouth. It will not return empty, but will accomplish what I desire and achieve the purpose for which I sent it. You have a purpose, and you have a purpose that God is going to use. And if you will get out of the way of you, he will use you to complete it. What God is saying here is, when I speak, the word will never return to me without accomplishing the purpose that I sent it out for. So let me let you in on something that you may not realize. Maybe you've never thought of this. God, Heavenly Father, King of kings, Lord of lords, creator of all things, has spoken over you. He's spoken over you. You and I will let God work in us through these character tests. You will discover your purpose. By the way, the one thing, and I want to reemphasize this, I told you this a couple of weeks ago, but the one thing that seems to trip people up from reaching their destiny, the greatest thing that seems to trip them up, is pride. Pride. Pride seems to be our biggest enemy, doesn't it? But I want you to remind you, as I've reminded you in every single one of these messages, don't worry, be happy. Because if you fail it, you're just going to get to take it again. And again. And again. And again. Until you get it right. How many times you take it is up to you. It's up to you. Wow. God really does want you to get to your destiny. Do you know that? He really does want to see you there. And that's why he allows you to keep retaking the test, because he really wants you to achieve your purpose on this earth. Do you realize, if you believe God is in control, you are an optimist? You're an optimist. And that's really the difference between being an optimist and a pessimist. A pessimist is always expecting the worst to happen, while an optimist believes that God does have the power to turn things around. I'm telling you what, right now we have a country full of pessimistic people. Because the last time I checked, God's still on the throne. Still in control. Have you heard about that pessimistic parachutist? Y'all heard that? There was a sergeant. He said this guy was going to be on a plane today, and that plane was going to go up to 10,000 feet. And he said, son, you're going to jump out, and when you do, I want you to take your right hand, after you've jumped, and put it on your left shoulder and pull the ripcord. Now, if that ripcord or that chute fails to deploy, I want you to take your left hand, put it on your right shoulder, and pull the ripcord. And that emergency parachute will open, and you will glide safely to earth, where there will be a group of trucks waiting to pick up all the parachuters and bring you back to base. So the guy gets on the plane, looks over at his buddy, and says, man, I bet this piece of junk can't even get up to 10,000 feet. Sure enough, it does. So the guy jumps out, takes his right hand, puts it on his left shoulder, pulls the ripcord. Nothing. Well, that figures. See, I knew that was going to happen. I knew it. So he takes his left hand and he puts it over on his right shoulder and pulls the safety ripcord. And nothing happens. And the guy's, just free falling. He's going, great. See, told you. The main one didn't work. The emergency one doesn't work. I bet you those trucks are going to be late. Some of you will get that Thursday when you get the other joke, too. It's not my day for good jokes. I'm telling you, it's really not. You have to believe you have a purpose. You, second, need to believe God is in control. Number three, you need to discover your gift and your direction. You need to discover your gift and your direction. This is the most critical step. If you are going to discover what your purpose is in this world, find out what your gift is. And by the way, y'all are in trouble because my watch is quit and not working. Okay. We could be here a while. This is the most critical step, all right? You need to find out what your gift is. Romans 12 has a list of gifts that pastors and teachers call motivational gifts. And I just want us to look at these right quickly. Romans 12, 4 through 8, if you have your Bible. Romans 12, 4 through 8. For just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function, so in Christ we, though many, form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. We have different gifts according to the grace given to us. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy in accordance with your faith. If it is serving, then serve. If it is teaching, then teach. If it is to encourage, then give encouragement. If it is giving, then give generously. If it is to lead, do it diligently. If it is to show mercy, do it cheerfully. Amen? So I'm going to give these seven gifts a quick name and describe them to you. So I got to move quickly because, again, I have no idea what time it is. 11:35. Okay, that gives me some kind of idea. All right. Number one, prophecy. A person that has the gift of prophecy is a person that has the gift as a motivator. All right, this person is a motivator. This person desires to motivate people to serve God. All right, number one, that's number one. Number two, servant. This person desires to meet the needs of people on a practical basis. We have a lot of those in this building, okay? Just so you know, we have a lot of servant people here. Teacher. A teacher desires to study and present truths to people. This person is diligently studying the Word, reading a bunch of supportive material, and probably has the Bible software on his or her phone. Okay? That's a teacher. Number three is encourager. These are people who desire to admonish or encourage people. Number four, giver. This is a person who desires to meet the needs of people on a financial basis. Now, I put a little side note to this, and I want you to listen to it very carefully. This is not a person who wants to help somebody who does not apply scriptural principles to their finances. All right? Let's put that in plain English. This is not a person that's going to continue to enable somebody else to continue to be the way they've always been. Okay? Just so you know. Number four, administrator. This person desires to lead people through organization. They're an organized leader. By the way, I think your elders have this gift. Okay? Several of our lay pastors have this gift. Number, I don't know what it is. Next one, sympathizer. Desires to sympathize and empathize with people. And I want to tell you, you can see all of these gifts in action in this church if you ever serve on a team. You can see them. Because there are a lot of people that have come together to form a team here at this church, and that's how we do ministry here. And they have these gifts, and they are applying these gifts inside this team. Now, every one of these gifts that we just mentioned has to do with helping or serving somebody other than yourself. Well, I got a very few amens out of that. I know I'm running a little bit late. Let me tell you why this is so critically, it burdens me. Because there's absolutely no reason in a church of 600 people, and I realize we don't have 600 here today, I get it. But there's no reason for a church of 600 people why 50 people or 60 people in this church ought to do everything. You can't tell me that there's 60 people in this church that now they're the only 60 that have a gift. Because we just read that everybody in this church has a purpose. We ought to have a plethora of help here. Amen? All right. Just let that sink in for a second. All right. Now, I've noticed there are a percentage of people who like to say, I used my gift to get the position, and now I don't have to do anything else because I'm in leadership. Oh, boy. I love that one. All right, let me just tell you something really quickly. If you get in a leadership position in this church, you are going to be 10 times more accountable than you are right now. Just telling you. Because I think God holds me accountable, God holds you accountable. Okay. Notice that Joseph was using his gift long before he actually got to the point where he realized what his gift was. Did you notice that? Yeah. So I want you to start right now using your gift, wherever you are, in some way that opens the door for you. All right? I want to read about a leader in this country, and I want to tell you what happened to him, and then I'll tell you who he was. All right? Listen carefully. At age 22, he failed in business. At age 23, he was defeated for the legislature. At 24, he failed in business again. At 26, his wife died. At 27, he had a nervous breakdown. At 29, defeated for Speaker of the House. At 34, defeated for Congress. At 39, defeated for Congress again. 46, defeated for Senate. 47, defeated for Vice President. 49, defeated for Senate again. At 51 years of age, he was elected President of the United States. Anybody know who that was? Abraham Lincoln. Abraham Lincoln. Now, if Lincoln, Abraham Lincoln, had said, well, look, I'm just going to give up. I quit. Abraham Lincoln understood that his purpose in this life was leadership. And he kept on, and he kept on, and he kept on, even through all of the adversity. And I'm going to tell you something, guys. Abraham Lincoln took us through one of the greatest tragedies in our nation's history. It's the only Civil War we've ever had. And had Abraham Lincoln not been the leader that he was and consistently understanding his purpose, I just wonder where this nation would have gone. Whew. Joseph, think about it. The butler, the baker had a dream. All three of them were in prison. Joseph's interpretation of these dreams is what got him out of prison. But what if Joseph had said, I don't know why I'm in here. It's not fair. We laugh, but we do that all the time, don't we? Lord, I don't know why I'm going through. I don't get it, Lord. I just don't know why I'm going through this. Joseph didn't do that. Joseph said, you know what? I'm in prison. God's with me. He's going to use me. And sure enough, he did. He never stopped believing that God was in control. Number four, determine your direction and be faithful. Determine your direction to be faithful. What is it? Okay, good. God has a purpose for your life and direction for you to move in. Here's what some of you may be wondering. Preacher, I want to know more of the specifics of my purpose. Am I supposed to have this job or this ministry? What am I supposed to do? And maybe you might even ask the question, can I know the specifics of my purpose? And the answer is, yes, you can. Yes, you can. So I'm fixing to tell you how. The next question might be, when can I know those specifics? This is when you're going to know them. You ready? This is the answer. After you start doing them. After you start doing them. Now, I'm going to read you a scripture, and I want you to listen carefully, because the word says, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my what? Okay. It does not say thy word is a spotlight to show me 25 years up the road. It says it is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. In other words, you got to start walking, and when you start walking, it's going to start illuminating. You got to start doing something with your purpose before you're going to know what your destiny and your purpose is ultimately is. That's why I said a while ago, You can't just sit in a chair. You can't just sit in a chair. I'm going to end today by reading something from a guy. And how many of you grew up in the Methodist Church? We got several. Okay. Yeah. Okay. That's another story. We'll have to tell you that story again later. But anyway, I want to read you something today. It's by John Wesley. And those of you who've been in the Methodist Church will know who this is, okay? And some of you that study theology and stuff like that, or church history, you might know as well. But this is John Wesley, which was an English cleric, theologian, and evangelist who was the leader of a revival movement within the Church of England known as the Methodist or Methodism, okay? These are actual entries into John Wesley's diary. Actual entries. So I want you to listen to these for a minute and tell me that you got issues. Right? And by the way, this also shows you if you are faithful with your gift, what God will do. All right? Sunday morning, May 5th, preached at St. Anne's, was asked not to come back. Sunday night, May 5th, by the way, that was the evening service, preached at St. John's. Deacon said, get out and stay out. Sunday morning, May 12th, preached at St. Jude's. Can't go back there either. Sunday morning, May 19th, preached in somebody else's, St. Somebody else's. Deacons call a special meeting and tell me not to return. Sunday night, May 19th, preached on the street, kicked off street. Sunday, May 26th, preached in the meadow, was chased out of the meadow by a bull. Sunday morning, June 2nd, preached at edge of town, was kicked off the highway. Sunday night, June 2nd, preached in a pasture. 10,000 people showed up. Now, guys, I got to tell you something. If that don't tell you, God has a purpose for your life. But there doesn't mean there's not going to be some obstacles. There doesn't mean there's not going to be some challenges. You stay the course. Keep exercising your gift, and God will open the doors for you to use it. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. I am always so blessed. I tell you what, I love this church. I love you. I just think God has blessed us so much. And I think there's a lot of people that are here this morning right now who are going, man, I need to find my purpose. I need a purpose. I need to know what that purpose is. And I think maybe back in the recesses of your mind and maybe in your heart, you kind of already know maybe what that purpose could be. But you've never actually started stepping out in faith and testing it a little bit. So this morning, what I'm going to ask you to do is for those of you who are saved, you believe in Jesus Christ, and you say, yeah, I know who Jesus Christ is, and yes, I believe that he has a purpose for me. I mean, I know that without a shadow of a doubt. But I'm just not sure what that purpose is. Then I want you to start praying right now. That God, this morning, this very day, would open up your mind and your heart to what that purpose could be in your life. And that you would begin to take steps, starting right now, starting today, towards that purpose that God's called you to start. Now, I'm going to tell you something. I'm going to speak on my youth minister for just a little bit. And I don't mean this to be funny at all, because it is. It's a truth. But Dave and Narenda, you know, very rarely do you see somebody who's retiring from a job, kind of getting ready to maybe start a different chapter, a different season in their life, who says, you know what? I'm going to go to youth camp. I'm going to step up and I'm going to help go to youth camp. And these two did that. And they got back and they said, man, I tell you what, we had the best time. It was awesome. And I looked at David, square in the eyes, and I said, David, you ever thought about being a youth minister? He goes, oh, no. No, 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 I do not want to do that. And I said, well, David, wait a minute. Pray about it, would you? He goes, man, I tell you what, it's just too late in the season of life for me right now to be a youth minister. And I said, well, I want you to understand something. Moses was 70 years old when he got started. Think about that for a minute. And he found his purpose. It's not about your age. It is about your heart. If God's calling you to do something, he's going to give you the tools to do it with. All you need to do is say, yes, here I am, Lord, send me. Send me. What is your purpose? Second thing is, this morning, if you're here today and you haven't received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, maybe you're going, well, I guess that leaves me out. No, it doesn't. I told you just a second ago, God has a purpose for every single one of you, even if you don't belong to him yet, and maybe your purpose today needs to be belonging to him. Maybe you need to start there. Maybe you need to give over your life this morning to Jesus Christ and say, look, I want a purpose. I want to know what my purpose is, but I need to know the master and the one that controls my destiny first. So this morning, I'm just going to ask you, as we pray, I pray that you'll receive Jesus Christ into your heart and that you will find a God-given purpose for your life. Father, we come to you this morning, Father, and I thank you so much, Father, for this time together. And Father, I thank you for the folks that are here this morning. I don't believe they're here by accident. I don't think they're listening by radio by accident. And I don't believe they're online by accident. So, Father, this morning, as we look towards our purpose in this life, Father, give us direction, give us an open heart, give us an open mind, and even more importantly, help us to step out right now in faith. We are called according to your purpose. And, Father, for that one that is here this morning who does not know you as a personal Lord and Savior, who is saying in their heart and in their mind right now, boy, I sure would like to know my purpose. Father, today I just pray that their purpose would be to receive you as Lord and Savior of their life. That they would open up their heart right now and say, Father, I am a sinner. I have fallen short. I've got a history. I've got things in my life, Lord, that I am just not proud of. But Father, if you will come into my heart today and forgive me of my sin, Father, I will claim you this day forward as Lord and Savior of my life. Father, thank you for dying on the cross for my sin. Thank you for the resurrection, the defeated death and hell. Father, I do not have to have any fear at all because I know that you are in control and that you rule. And I submit my life to you today. It's in Jesus Christ's name we pray.